My name is Phil Fenimore with the Australian Building Codes Board, and today I'm going to talk to you about masonry construction and the details within Volume 2 and the housing provisions of NCC 2022. H1D5 of Volume 2 sets out the deemed to satisfy pathways shown in this slide. On the right hand side is AS3700 or the 4773 1 and 2 suite of standards. This is known in 2019 as an acceptable construction manual, simply referenced in the housing provisions for 2022 as reference documents. If you choose this path, they're the relevant standards. If you don't choose this path, you can go to part 5.4, that's on the left-hand side of this slide, which are the deemed to satisfy requirements set out in the housing provisions for 2022. So to be clear, for masonry, there's a choice, a complete choice between an referenced Australian standard 3700 or 4773 or part 5.4 of the housing provisions. Comparisons between 2019 Volume 2 and the housing provisions, which is where the deemed to satisfy requirements are for masonry construction. On the left, part 3.3, 2019, starts at 331, go through to part 336. Unreinforced masonry, all the way through to isolated masonry piers. What we've changed for NCC 2022 is the addition of cavity masonry deemed to satisfy requirements and unreinforced single leaf masonry requirements. These are in addition to those of 2019, and I'll talk about some details of those and how Volume 2 connects those to the housing provisions. H1D5 is the relevant deemed to satisfy provision in Volume 2 for masonry. And this is the connection between the relevant Australian standards, if you choose those as the deemed to satisfy solution, so that's 3700 or 4773, parts 1 and 2. Or if you choose to use the deemed to satisfy requirements of the housing provisions, it will take you to part 5.2, that's in H1D5 1C. And this is where the limitations exist if you use the housing provisions. Noting the first one there is the maximum wind speed for a design of a building using the housing provisions is not to be more than N3, a wind speed of N3. Other limitations relate to the classification of the site, A, S and M. That's a site classification that's also similar to that for footings and slab construction. So the limitations there for wind speed, site classification, and also a new requirement that speaks to design for earthquake. If you have a design for earthquake in a house or any residential construction, it's limited to the extent that you have to go back into the Australian standards 3700 or 4773 for your solution. So in summary, if your building requires earthquake design, you have to go back to the relevant Australian standard. You can't continue to use the housing provisions. Talking in a bit of detail about part 5.3, cavity masonry, and we're talking about limitations within the element of cavity masonry as a type of wall. So we've discussed the fact that there are limitations set out broadly in Volume 2 in H1D5, but if you go to cavity masonry in the housing provisions, because that's the DTS solution that you choose, you'll note that there are also limitations for that particular element of construction. And in this case, as an example, there's limitations on the height, there's requirements for masonry cross walls that are subject to wind loads to have support either by a masonry cross wall or steel mullions. And stating the obvious, in subclause 2 there, cavity masonry must be constructed with 2 leaves, because that's how we form our cavity, and each of those leaves needs to be a minimum of 90 millimetres wide. Also, talking about cavities is a requirement to have a cavity that has a minimum and a maximum dimension. So there's a limitation there, or a value of a minimum 35 millimetres up to 75 millimetres for a cavity, noting that any services with the exception of mullions within that cavity need to be clear and maintain those dimensions. If you do put steel mullions into a cavity, you need to make sure that there is a moisture barrier on the outside leaf between the inside masonry wall and the external part of that steel mullion. That's in 5.3.23C. Okay, looking at unreinforced single leaf masonry, it's part 5.4 of the Housing Provisions 2022. This particular figure sets out a requirement for external walls to be continuously connected to a roof frame. This is not the only deemed to satisfy solution, but it is the only one contained in the housing provisions. If you choose a different method to this, that's okay, but you would need to get that solution from either of the relevant Australian standards, that's 3700 or the 4773 suite. Also, for unreinforced single leaf masonry, going to the tables, in particular relating to engaged piers, we've changed the format of the tables for NCC 2022. And they look a bit like this now to meet our digital platform. We've set them out with the same information, they're just in a new look with new table notes that are relevant to the information in the table. These tables also are supported by figures, which we'll get to in some slides coming up. But importantly to note that there are limitations within these tables, in this case for engaged piers, the maximum wind speed of N3, noting that for a different thickness of wall, there are different solutions and spacings for the size of engaged piers, depending on what you choose for whatever design your house will take on. A table note worth understanding in this particular table is for 140mm and 190mm thick walls. If you read that note, it means you don't necessarily have to have engaged piers, noting that table notes are normative and not informative. So if you have a wall with a thickness of 140mm up to 190mm, you don't need to provide engaged piers. These diagrams, or this diagram rather, shows and supports the information in that table, and it simply sets out maximum dimensions in terms of height, spacings between engaged piers and permissible openings. If any of these dimensions are exceeded, it would mean you exceed the dimensions in that table, and if that's the case, you would need to go back to the relevant Australian standard for the design solution. So looking at part 5.4, unreinforced single leaf masonry, specifically internal walls now, note that in 5.4.3A, there's a minimum thickness for an internal wall to be 75mm, that's the size of the masonry unit. And also there in B, we're talking about the connection of these internal walls into the ceiling diaphragm. Just like we do for timber framing in houses, we have a solution that will set out for a minimum thickness of wall of either 75mm right up to 190, a particular height, limitation on the height, but importantly, those diagrams on the right there are different methods of achieving connection to the ceiling diaphragm that still allows for differential movement. These are not the only solutions. Again, if you choose a different solution to these ones, you would have to go back to AS 3700 or 4773 parts 1 or 2. Supporting that information, those particular clauses also in part 5.4 for internal walls. Other ways of achieving lateral stability is through return walls, shown in this figure, noting that there are dimensions for wing walls, maximum spacings of abutting internal walls, and also maximum sizes of openings, including articulation joints. Overall, for part 5.6, the comparison between 2019 and 2022, that is 2019 Volume 2 and 2022 Housing Provisions. You'll note that we've added a new Part 5.6. It's dedicated to masonry components and accessories. And the reason we've done that is to combine all of the accessories and components relative to masonry veneer, cavity masonry, single leaf masonry, isolated piers. We put them all in one place so that we're not repeating what we're saying in each of those separate parts. An important thing to note for masonry components and accessories in this clause, 5.6.6, is a new clause dealing with fixing straps and tie-down systems. So in summary, there are requirements for timber, door and window frames abutting cavity masonry. That's in subclause 1 there. There are requirements for roof tie-down for external walls that support sheet metal and tile roofs, that's subclause 2. And in this subclause, note the requirement for tie-down straps to be at a 1200 millimetre centre maximum and also connected to or adjacent to rafters or trusses. Subclause 3, we're talking about roof framing supporting tiled roofs on single leaf unreinforced masonry. And subclause 4 is talking about roof framing supporting sheet roofs on single leaf reinforced masonry. An important thing to note in the explanatory information in masonry components and accessories is illustrated here. I mentioned a moment ago the 1200 millimetre centres for tie down straps. If you have a length of wall and it contains an opening and that opening is greater than 1200 millimetres wide, it still needs to be tied down, but the important thing to note is there are no deemed to satisfy solutions. So that 1200 millimetre opening, or if it's greater than 1200 millimetres, the solution for tie down across that opening, as noted in that explanatory information, you'll need to seek a solution separately because there are no DTS provisions in the housing provisions, nor are there any in either of the relevant Australian standards, 3700 or 4773. Because we've added single leaf masonry into the housing provisions for 2022, we've got a clause dedicated to weatherproofing single leaf masonry should the building you're designing require weatherproofing, not necessarily used for carports or garages using single leaf masonry, but if there's a case where you need to prevent moisture from outside to the inside in a residential part of the building, 5.7.6 sets out how you achieve that weatherproofing.